Good evening. My name is Carl Weaver. I'm a wireless market mobile device specialist for the Chinese and Indian mobile device manufacturing ecosystem. I've spent 20 plus years in the state helping Western companies sell mobile technologies to the Chinese and Asia Pacific world. I'm previously a Gemalto and Trustonic employee on the security side. I've been currently working for a French-owned, French-invested smart card manufacturer out of Singapore called Oasis Smart Sim. Tonight I'll be presenting under the moniker of Newport Technologies. I've been presenting in the States since 2003. What I always like to do is discuss cutting-edge technologies that haven't quite reached America's shores. Because quite honestly, on the mobile security side, on the mobile payment side, and this whole embedded SIM ecosystem, this doesn't come from the United States, I hate to tell you. I've been involved in it. It's really just the French, the Germans, and the Dutch who are really very specialized on smart card technologies. Yes, we're Americans own the semiconductor industry. Yes, we still do. Unfortunately, we're all fabless, and it's all outsourced to TSMC in Taiwan. This is really important for us to understand. Why? Because you're all software people here. You're 5,000 miles away from where the actual manufacturing of the hardware takes place. Hence, there is part of the problem with the security risks on all of this technology on these mobile devices. Tonight, what I want to talk to you about is this embedded SIM technology. In fact, I'm going to talk about three things. Embedded SIM, eSIM, or typically is EUICC. I'm also going to talk about RSP, remote SIM provisioning. Some call it on-demand connectivity. The third thing I'll talk about, and I forgot to take my Samsung Gear S2, which was given to me by Samsung via T-Mobile a month ago. I have a Samsung Gear S2 smartwatch. In my humble opinion, it's an IoT device. It's also a wearable payment device. Actually, payment on a smartwatch is a killer app. Anybody listening to that on the watch side, maybe Paris? This is very, very important. People are not going to buy a smartwatch simply because I can tell my heart rate. They'll buy a fitness band, and that's $50 to $100. They're going to buy a smartwatch because they want standalone connectivity. So tonight, let me go through the slides myself. I think the key here is that eSIM for consumers is a game changer. Why? It's going into everything, absolutely everything, and we don't perhaps realize it. Does anybody have a smart, high-end car with an embedded SIM to get 4G connectivity and then Wi-Fi in the car? Anybody have that? Fantastic. I have a 2010 Toyota Prius. I can only pray when I can afford a car with such...
it's aftermarket.
Okay, that's perfect. So actually, eSIM is going into everything. It's going into wearable payment smartwatches right now. It's going into tablets. It's actually in the Apple iPad Pro. It's actually, the Apple SIM is actually in the iPad Mini 3, 4, iPad Pro, iPad Air 2. There's a company over in Redmond. They just made an announcement 2 days ago. I've been pursuing this company, very fragmented organization sometimes. I've been pursuing this company for about a year, trying to ask them, are you going to put embedded SIM in your Surface tablet? Well, we might. It's possible. They made an announcement 2 days ago. Hell, I knew this a year ago, that Microsoft was going to put the embedded SIM in their Surface tablet. Hello, that's the way you sell more of them globally. So tonight's presentation is about these three topics. Let's go on. It's very important to understand that there are lots of wireless protocols in the world today. Hello, lots of hype as well. In my humble opinion, the 4G ecosystem is moving rapidly to narrowband IoT, which is for IoT related types of solutions, both on the industrial, consumer, and this whole segment we call connected cars. But I also think that some of these protocols aren't going to go that far as well. You've got things like ZigFox, you've got things like LoRa that are moving forward. You've got all kinds of 3G, 4G, and 5G protocols now. You've got Wi-Fi, Bluetooth. Anybody who's in security knows there's no security with that. 4G, LTE, Wi-WAN, broadband connectivity. Nobody's cracking that. It hasn't been cracked. Where are my friends from T-Mobile? Oh, they left. Okay, they probably would like that pitch though. Let me move forward. So witnessing the evolution of eSIM, or what technical people call EUICC. What is E? E means embedded. UICC, Universal Integrated Circuit Card. This is important to understand. Right now we're involved with the traditional SIM in our mobile devices, right? It's actually disposable. We throw them away. They're invalid. If you get one overseas and after 6 months you haven't used it, they take that phone number and recycle it. And it's also not reprogrammable. Not reprogrammable by anybody, actually. Now you have the embedded or reprogrammable multi-application. It's late, people. SIM is an application of an embedded secure element. Does anybody know what a secure element actually is? Deer in the headlights? Okay, it's tamper-resistant hardware security. This is what you want to use so that hackers cannot infiltrate your devices. My God, if we had tamper-resistant security in hardware, you guys might not have a job. Anyway, that's a solid
point. Have you had a developer lately?
eSIM. SIM runs as the only application of an embedded chip. Well, okay, so actually, as I said before, the French, the Germans, and the Dutch, they own the smart card industry, okay? We Americans are still making chips, right, but it's all made in China, actually. All these smart cards are mostly made in China. This embedded SIM, this eSIM, is reprogrammable. Soft SIM, what is that? Well, that's interesting because it's simply software as an application that resides on the open operating system of the device. However, there are lots of companies who would like to take that soft SIM, and they have creative ideas for what to do with that soft SIM. Companies like Qualcomm, Intel, and HiSilicon, which is a Huawei's chip business. These guys have specifically said they'd like to do away with the SIM card industry. They'd like to take the profile of the operative and put it right into the chip. Yes, it is tragic. It is dramatic, yes. yes, but don't worry. I worked for Jamal Toll promoting near-field communications in China for a few years, and then they put me on this thing called the TEE. This is exactly what T-Mobile is using right now for their so-called SIM lock on all their Android-based devices. This TEE is actually, it's a firewall environment in the chip, in the mobile applications processor chip. Every single chip vendor on the planet is using this right now for various reasons. Streaming video content protection, high definition video content protection, protection of mobile wallet PIN codes, mobile wallet payment, and credential data. This is important stuff. The soft SIM has a place in the world. I just not 100% sure where it's going. If you talk to the GSMA, if you talk to operators, they'll say, when hell freezes over, we'll use this technology. I think like the Eagles, hell might freeze over. All right, so what is the GSMA? Who knows what the GSMA is? Anybody? Okay. It used to be called Group System Mobile, but it's now called the Global System of Mobile Communications Association or something like that. It's based in London, CEO is an American. By the way, next week they're gonna have the largest trade show for wireless technology on the planet in Barcelona, Spain. Welcome to Barcelona. But it's important that they've standardized this embedded SIM on devices. That's what they've done. They have a three-phase program. First phase is done. That's going into your connected cars. So one car can actually talk to another car. One car can get the 4G connectivity in the car for telematics and infotainment and other things. Phase two, which is where I'm focusing my energies on the consumer electronics side. Phase two, that's where we are right now. That's exactly where we are right now. Phase three is an enterprise play, but the key is it's called remote SIM provisioning. Some people call it on-demand connectivity. So we mentioned a little bit about ESE. E means embedded, SE means a secure element. Secure element is actually the physical tamper-resistant hardware of the eSIM, of inside the SIM. So SIM is actually a Java card app. Helios eSIM, it's a physical SIM, it's basically embedded, it's hermetically sealed, it's soldered onto the hardware of the device. Hence, when you have an embedded SIM, you can almost guarantee it's going to be waterproof. Okay, because that's one of the major reasons to have an embedded SIM, as well as more reducing the architecture, reducing about $3 off the price of anything going on a device. Helios, again, as I said, is a soft SIM. We can move forward. It's important to understand the value proposition. Why do I want an eSIM? Well, you have no choice because the manufacturers are all doing it. Why? Because removable SIMs are a problem. They're a problem in validity. They're a problem sometimes with how long you can use them, especially if you go overseas, you buy a subscription plan, and you pay $100 for a data plan. if you can get one, more difficult to get these days. And then you discover you've left the country. 6 months later, you go back. Can I use my SIM? No. Why not? Well, you weren't using it. No, it wasn't stolen. But basically what happened is they recycled that number. You didn't use it. They took you out of service. This is what happens when you have a removable SIM in another country. But with eSIM, that's all going to change. It's all going to change. The first device on this planet with an embedded SIM, compliant with the GSMA's remote SIM provisioning program, is the Samsung Gear S2. AT&T, T-Mobile, and Verizon are all selling this product. This is a pretty good smartwatch. Women aren't going to buy it. Not enough fashion. Not enough fashion. These men, design engineers, have to get this right. You need a unisex device so that women will buy it. It's fact. Yeah, they're laughing, but it's true. So, all right. You have to embed it into the device. Tablet, smartwatch, eventually smartphone. I'll explain why it hasn't shown its ugly face from a smartphone yet. You have to connect it. You have to physically use Bluetooth or Wi-Fi or whatever means to actually connect it to an operator's network, an OTA network in the cloud or basically the operator's network. And then finally, you have to actually create the activation. What is the activation? That's your subscription for T-Mobile or any other operator around the world. But here's the cool thing. You're going to be able to do that yourself on the watch, although that seems a little tricky. You might want to do it with the PC and the watch using Bluetooth, right? But you'll be able to do it with your smartphone, with your tablet. Actually, you can do it right now with the iPad Pro. Does anybody own an iPad Pro? Apple? Fruit sounding company.
There's literally one right here.
All right. So this is how, but this is the value proposition to get to the connectivity, and these are the customers, the MNOs are going to use this technology, but they don't own it. They don't make it, they don't own it. The OEMs and ODMs, they buy it. Do they own it? Well, they actually physically own it. It's going on their device. But it's going to be used for the MNO, the M2M, and the IoT service providers as well. So they have a play in this, but it's actually the smart card vendors who are in the middle supplying the actual technology for this. And the markets are mobile devices, M2M, and IoT. A smartwatch is an IoT device. I keep saying that. eSIM, uSIM engagement models. These are some of the engagement models involved that I've been involved in. You've got the physical SIM. You've got NXP, which supplies a secure element. It's mostly for payment. The NFC controller chip vendor, NXP. They were bought by Qualcomm recently. You have what's called a subscription manager. I'll talk about this more in depth in a minute. And basically, you have what we call multi-MZ, International Mobile Subscriber ID. What is that? That's actually the operator's profile. That's what the operator's profile is. Let me go further, because I think I might be losing some. Anybody lost, or am I doing okay here? You're all right? All right, good. All right. So embedded OS subscription management model. Well, okay, so what is it? A subscription management model, a subscription manager, goes inside the embedded SIM. It manages the profile. It manages how you get the profile. It also manages the security. You have a data preparation portion of it. Profile ordering prepares unpersonalized profile, generates personalization. It brings the data from the operator and gets it ready to download to the device. That's what it does. The other part of it is the secure routing, to securely get it from the operator's network onto the physical device. You need the security to do that. Encryption, cryptographic keys, etc., public private keys, etc., etc. It does all of that. And it handles multi-MZ. Right. We move forward. This is kind of an interesting model here. eSIM represents a decoupling of the ownership of the MNO to the OEM. What does that mean? Well, don't I buy my smartphone from the mobile network operator? Normally you do, but things are changing. T-Mobile has a program. Has anybody heard of the Digits program? Anybody at all? Cool. Well, what do you know about the Digits program? Most of us know nothing.
I have a new phone number.
So the Digits program is very cool, and what it is this GSMA remote SIM provisioning program, or a part of it is this GSMA remote SIM provisioning program. It is very, very cool, quite honestly. So how does it work? The mobile device manufacturer, he gets the SIM, he deals with all the operator's profiles, which get downloaded from the OTA server or the OTA network, downloaded into the device through the eSIM, and then he deals with the end user, which is you. What's great about this is you get to set up the subscription. You get to set this thing up. You don't have to rely on the operator anymore, on the mobile network operator anymore. That's very, very interesting. However, just think about this. There's something called a bootstrap. No matter what, the bootstrap is always going to be resident in the country where it's set up. It has to be that way. You can't have more than one profile operating at one time as well. So you can't have Verizon, AT&T, T-Mobile all operating at the same time. Does not work that way. The guys in Microsoft, the guys in Samsung, and the guys in Apple have made sure that this is a very fair and very neutral way of downloading the operator's profile onto your device when you're in your home country. And then they've got something called remote location registry, so that when you're roaming into another country, you are able to download, let's say, China Mobile's profile, because you're going to go to China Mobile for 1 week, right? You want a data plan. Do you realize if you go into a foreign country right now, they're going to ask you for a local mailing address? And they're going to say, well, if you don't have a local mailing address, I'm sorry. It's going to be difficult to give you a SIM card for your device, because we're concerned about terrorism. This is fact. Anybody ever try to get a data plan by just buying a SIM card in another country? Anybody ever try that? Okay, I guess you guys don't travel much. Basically, it's a problem these days. They're concerned about terrorism. Let me go further. This is how it's set up. This is the device that has a bootstrap. The bootstrap has to be physically set up with the home location registry of the device that of the country that it's in, right? And it goes and talks to the server. Once you turn on the subscription, it talks to the server, it provides a profile, and you can have multiple different profiles. This could be T-Mobile. This one could be China Mobile, Italian Telecom, Dutch Telecom. I can have a number of these embedded and ready because I paid for the subscription. All that's required is that you pay for the subscription. And you can have it for a day, a month, a week, a year, as long as you want. It's very cool. It's very, very cool, and it's coming. Just telling you it's coming. What does it do? It loads the IMSI, then it loads the profile for 2G, 3G, or 4G, whatever is resident in that country. This is a subscription manager. It's actually a piece of software that runs inside of the embedded SIM that various people can get access to. US end users get access to very limited details. You can set up your subscription. That's what the subscription manager does. But an MNO, an MVNO, and a service provider for M2M, they can do much more. They have much more access to things that they can set up and program. You have simple access. We have customer onboarding. But it's basically because it uses the cloud to take the bootstrap from the operator's network and send it down into your device because you want to set up your subscription for T-Mobile. That is basically how this technology works. It's very cool.
Is there a central gatekeeper who's monitoring every profile you have?
A gatekeeper?
For lack of a better word. I'm sure there'd be somebody interested in every profile you had in every country.
Like in the
Yeah, so this is part of the conflict of interest issue. It's a very good question because the bootstrap is technically your decision to set up for the first one, but it has to be set up with the operators in that particular country because it goes out and looks for the home location registry of the device in that country. Okay. So I would think that the first operator that gets the bootstrap, really he's in control of your destiny almost because you're going to default back to him each time. You will default back to him.
Or she.
I'm not going to say it yet, but it could be it. So there really should be somebody overseeing this. There is. The GSMA is making sure that the standards, the security, is all set up so that the MNO can't take control of this technology. The OEM handset manufacturer cannot also take control of this technology. And even the smart card maker that makes the technology has no priority control over this technology. Actually, you have the control because you make the decision which operator you're going to set up for the bootstrap and then which operator you're going to use when you roam outside the country and set up the additional subscription that you need. And there's actually, guess what? This is going on right now. Did you know that? If you buy an iPad Pro, turn that baby on. You want to set in it, by the way, it has to be the 4G LTE Wi-Fi connectivity version. So it has to be 4G. You can add a SIM card. The iPad Pro allows, it's a hybrid device. It allows for you to add the Apple SIM. Apple SIM costs you $10 at the Apple Store. And if they give you deer in the headlights, Apple SIM, Tell them, yeah, it costs $10. That's what it costs. You can buy it. You buy it, you put it into either your iPad, iPad Mini 3, iPad Mini 4, iPad Air 2, or iPad Pro. Put it in there, and you can set up an MVNO for when you travel outside the country. It's called Gig Sky. I've got a slide talking about that. But I wanted to just kind of show the complexity of the ecosystem. It's really, really complex. Really complex. Ah, but it's all standardized, and guess what? It's coming. It's coming fast. I moved too quick.
So who has access to the data that's on your phone? Just you, or do providers have a list of all the profiles?
The providers don't have a list of all the other profiles. They have a list of their profile. The provider only has a list of their profile. That's the only profile they're able, and that's actually the one that they want. However, the MVNO is a little bit different than an MNO. They collect IMSIs, they collect profiles. They want to give you various profiles, they want to give you access to various profiles. So actually an MVNO is a better solution for lots of people who travel all over the world and don't want to deal with calling up T-Mobile 611 customer service. They want to deal with an MVNO because an MVNO may understand their roaming business a little bit better. So actually, the MVNO gets a little bit more access than you, the end user, does to this technology. The MNO gets as much access as they want, because ultimately it's their network.
Is the privacy implications, who's going to have what?
Yes, so there's a technology called secure routing that's standardized. The GSMA Remote SIM Provisioning Program 3.1, that's the spec. It's a damn long spec, but that's the spec for the secure routing of this technology. First you set up the provision, and then you use the secure routing to download it onto the device. And by the way, you need either an embedded SIM, but actually, if you look at this right here, it's very cool. When I say embedded SIM, it's a little bit elusive in that you can also have, if this sounds crazy, you can have a removable embedded SIM. Mm-hmm. There's your embedded SIM right there. Gold fingers are the best contact quality. There's your embedded SIM right there, but you can actually have a removable embedded SIM as well, because guess what? Not all the manufacturers around the world are ready for this technology, but T-Mobile wants to launch this soon, so they'll be supplying the guys who don't have it embedded yet with one of these, because it's a different SIM than a regular SIM. It's an M2M SIM. Okay. So actually, this is the subscription manager, and we're talking about wearables now. So this is how you would set it up. Notice the bootstrap. Who is it set to? It's set to Italia Telecom. All right, so obviously this smartwatch is in Italy. It's set to Italia Telecom. But I have set my second subscription to Choice Wireless, which is in Silicon Valley. I've set my third to Marathon Telecom. Don't know where that is. And here, Vodafone, that's probably Netherlands. Look at that. I have four different subscriptions, but the defaults back to the bootstrap when I'm in my country. This is very cool stuff. This is not vaporware, guys. Even though you may never have heard about this before, this is not vaporware. It's just that in America, we're laggards with so many things. So this is how you might see and set up your subscription. It's very cool. Now, I want anybody here have a Samsung Gear S2 or Gear S3 right now? Anybody? I had one, but I was charging it. These babies will only get you 48 hours of charge time, actually. That's it. That's it, maximum.
It's actually better than my phone. I'm lucky if I get 24.
Well, I neglected to tell you, I turned off the Bluetooth. I turned off the Wi-Fi. It has GPS. Actually, the Samsung Gear S2 and the Gear S3 are the most sophisticated smartwatches on the planet. I know if you have an Apple iWatch, it's a great device, but it's not very smart, actually. Those devices give you the Dick Tracy ability. Hey, R54, where are you? You can actually call and receive a phone call. So that's very, very cool. It exists right now. It's just not enough people know about it. But if you look, I answered your question, right? Or I tried to. Right, so we have the Samsung Gear S2, which is what I have. That's a Samsung Gear S2. That's a great watch, but come on, is a woman going to buy that? I don't think so. They have a sport version. Women will buy that. They've told me. This is the Samsung Gear S3. It's been out in the market since last November. It's a great product. It's also standalone. So it has a 4G embedded SIM there. And by the way, a plan from T-Mobile is, I think, like $10 or $15 max. But if you're a T-Mobile user, last November they had a free special, free phone line. Hello, Houston, that's great. So I have a free phone line, or it cost me $5 a month. Now, this Gig Sky is what I talked to you about. If you have an Apple iPad Pro. It has a removable slot, and it also has an embedded SIM. It's a hybrid device, it has both. You're gonna see more of those devices which have hybrid functionality. It's gonna be very important, actually. So Apple has this flexible strategy to work with GigSky, which is a mobile network virtual operator. It's very, very cool stuff. You're still here, you haven't fallen asleep, you haven't left, you haven't quite left. This is good. Now, I wanna talk about security. Why? Because you're all security people, that's why you're here. As I told you, I worked for Gemalto and I worked for Trustonic, promoting first near-field communications technology to all the handset manufacturers in Taiwan and China. And then they put me on this technology called the TE, which they bought a company called Trusted Logic, which turned into Trustonic in 2013, a joint venture between Arm, Gemalto, and G&D, now just Arm and Gemalto. Okay, so let's talk about security on mobile devices, because we really need to. I could have it in the phone's memory, right? But you software people, you realize anything in the open operating system, savvy hackers will be able to steal your credentials, your data. Your credentials are very important to you. Well, you could use the regular SIM card, yes. But the company I'm not talking about terrorism here, the company called ISIS, remember that organization? That was AT&T, Verizon, and T-Mobile. They set a mobile payment network up in this country.
Yeah, that was a brand mistake.
I guess so. You can actually store, because it has a secure element, you can actually store sensitive payment data in the secure element of the SIM card for ISIS, which is made by Gemalto. Gemalto, I think, supplies T-Mobile their SIM cards. But I was also promoting this technology, which is very cool. What is it? It's a firewall environment in the mobile apps processor chip. It allows you to take rich OS applications and port them with cryptographic keys, both a public and a private key, into this firewall environment so that you get to launch your streaming video content and no hackers can't get to it. You get to launch your mobile wallet application and use your biometric authentication. Does anybody know that Apple has two forms of security where they do mobile payment? Does anybody know that? So the first form is they use an embedded NFC controller chip, right? And that's where they store the secure element with the payment credentials. But the biometric authentication is what? It's software, it's an algorithm. So they take the biometric authentication algorithm, which is a database, and they make sure that when you put your thumb on the device, it's going out, it's going into the TE to look for the right database user to authenticate. That's how it authenticates. It does it in security, in the TE security. That's how Apple does it. It's very cool. That's why Apple and BlackBerry, the fruit-sounding companies, have the best security on mobile devices. It's a fact. Now we have the embedded SIM. The embedded SIM is basically very secure because it also has the secure element. And it has the highest level of security. Some people are using what we call software TE. It's not safe, it's not secure. But some people are trying to use a virtual SIM along with a TE. So they're putting a virtual SIM, not the physical SIM, but a piece of software, and they're putting it inside the TE, which is a firewall inside the mobile applications processor chip. That can work. I don't know about, it's not the highest level of security, but it is security. Let's talk about exactly what I mentioned, the TE and Arm Trust Zone. So Arm Trust Zone is the firewall environment. The TE is simply the security OS that goes into the firewall. Rich operating system, apps, they go into the TE, they provide cryptographic keys, private and public keys. Private key is stored in the manufacturing process. Public key is given to you when you pay. Oh yeah, there you go. Everything costs money. And it does a lot of things, secure processing, secure input, secure storage, secure display, and secure biometrics. That's what Apple is doing for the app so that you can have frictionless Apple Pay. It's a very, very good product. And it's scaling now. I started this in 2010 with this technology, and I had so many people, including the Chinese government, tell me, well, this will never come into China. Mm-hmm. I said, bullshit, it won't. Yes, it will, and now it is. And now it's standardized also inside China. Can the TE, can HC NFC, HC, does anybody know what that means? Host card emulation. It basically is NFC, but it's taking the token and provisioning it in the cloud and then bring it back onto the mobile device. Android smartphones use this technology. Apple does not use this technology. Android smartphones use this technology. But anyway, it's NFC plus the TE, and they're providing security. So Everybody familiar with how the token works? It changes, it scrambles the number every 15 minutes. And it's very, very cool. And by the way, that's also in all of your credit cards right now. I'm gonna tell you another little secret. Anybody go to Costco? Anybody use Costco?
Yes.
Okay, good. You know what that is? What's that? What is that? That's NFC, guys and gals, ladies and gentlemen.
Hope you have a shielded wallet.
Look. NFC is pretty secure. But I understand your suspicions because there are companies, credit card companies, who use RFID, which doesn't have a proper security. NFC does, absolutely. Let me move forward. That would be a discussion we could have offline if you want to take it further. And I know you probably do. Look, hardware, all right? Tamper resistant, hackers. This is not, is anybody here a hacker? No, you can't get here, all right? Hackers, window of opportunity right over here. They have software using cloud. No security. Software TE, hell not much security. The TE, it's really right about in the middle. It provides an adequate level of security for lots of applications. Hell, T-Mobile's using it right now for something called SimLock. You call and ask them. And then, of course, there's the embedded secure element and the regular SIM. These are the securest capabilities for tamper resistant security, and nobody's cracked that stuff. All right, end of security. Okay, did you watch it? Went by real fast. All right. Now I want to talk about something really important. So why I said we're laggards in this country? Well, we are, because we know jack about payment. We hardly know about mobile device security because it's all coming from outside the country into America. I'm not politically correct, and the hell with that. Here's the key point. Here's the real key point. You go to Asia, you go to Europe. They're using their smartwatches to do payment in the subway. What the hell are we doing here? Deer in the headlights. Are we not the United States of Donald Trump's America? Do we not want service, payment, security? We do not want to be the laughing stock of the world. So hence, I engaged with trying to talk to Sound Transit, TriMet, and the Clipper Card down in Portland, the BART system, to talk to them about creating a wearables strategy. They need it, they want it. The problem is there's no real service provider to provide such services. But if you go to Asia, NFC-enabled rings. This is my wife's sock. She'll kill me if I lose it. This is not an NFC-enabled ring. This is the ancient technology. This is gold. But NFC-enabled rings, wristbands, and smartwatches with NFC technology, they're using in Asia and Europe now to do mobile payments. In fact, the Samsung Gear S2 and the Samsung Gear S3 have NFC enabled in the device so that you can do mobile payments. Is this important? Hell yes, it's very, very important. What are we doing about it? Well, it's my job to evangelize it. That's what I'm trying to do here. So you can see.
It's a MasterCard, that's why we don't have it. Exactly. It's too hard, is what they've been saying for 10 years.
Mm-hmm. Have you been to Asia lately?
Well, isn't most technology like that? Because I remember in Japan 20 years ago, I saw the little CD-ROM, and now they had
a little bit different because the technology for NFC actually was not invented in Japan. However, the Japanese used a Sony chip called the Felica chip, and they created a hybrid, a deviant of this technology because Sony was one of the creators of near-field communications technology, which is embedded into the chip. So the Japanese and Hong Kong, of all places, were the leaders with contactless technology, cards, plastic, and even on mobile devices. They were the leaders in the world. And now the rest of the world is catching up, and I helped to enable that in China. So this technology for the NFC, Gemalto, formerly known as Gem Plus, created the smart card, which was made into a SIM card, and we started using SIM cards in this state about 1998, if you recall. VoiceStream, first provider. VoiceStream, anybody remember that? Before they became T-Mobile. It was a long time ago. But the NFC technology comes from Nokia, minor player, Sony, and Philips, which turned the name into NXP. So this all needs to happen more in the United States. It's going on in Asia. Let me explain why. Because there's a company in Shenzhen called Shenzhen Snowball Technology. They're working with NXP to provide a complete service provider network for subway usage with inside with Beijing, Shanghai, Shenzhen, and Guangzhou public transportation authorities. Man, that's really cool stuff. Why are we not doing that here? All right, this is a really important question. Don't you agree? I think he agrees. It's going to happen. It's going to be slow. And we understand Sound Transit is spending their money, you know, building the extension to Linwood and also to Everett. But to not see what's going on in Asia, to put the blinders on, see no evil, this is wrong. This is wrong. So this is my summary. Fairly politically correct, huh? This is my summary. So the eSIM, the EUICC, it's tailored to meet requirements of miniaturization. You know, you need that kind of watch. It looks kind of stupid to take the watch off and put a SIM card in. It looks dumb, okay? Its ease of integration for any kind of device is soldered. It's plugged in, okay? It's soldered on, which is better than being actually physically plugged in. It supports the over-the-air, some call on-demand connectivity, which, by the way, you will turn on. It supports this RSP from the GSMA. This RSP remote SIM provisioning, it's based on the GSMA spec 3.1 for global platform standards. Global platform only standardizes two things, the secure element and the TE. That's it. Does anybody know global platform? They standardize security on devices. It empowers OEMs to provide seamless subscription management, on-demand connectivity to the customers, and enables OEMs to develop their own partnership strategies with OEMs across the globe. What you're going to see right now, when this technology gets turned on by T-Mobile and AT&T, by the way, it's going to get turned on. As soon as we figure out how to market it to America, it's got to get turned on. And then what you're going to see is top 10 M&O lists. Well, who's got the best roaming, who's got the best plan for when I travel into the country using embedded SIM? You, the end users, will get to choose and you get to select the M&Os. What's going to happen is M&Os in this country who fear, like most M&Os, fear this technology, well, they can't stop it. But M&Os in this country will first fear it, but then they'll realize, well, now I can open myself up to my services to the globe, whereas now it's just Americans, right? And some of those foreigners who come in, they buy a roaming SIM card. Now I open up my services to the globe to come to America and use my services on these embedded SIM devices. Secondly, it opens up to those operators around the world, your T-Mobile or your Verizon services to be used, I mean, your services to be subscribed from all over the world when they come into this country. Isn't that very, very cool? So this technology, you know, you can't have a garden wall mentality. First of all, it's a spec, it's a standard, it's already in high-end 4G connect, high-end connected cars. It's going into lots of industrial devices. I haven't talked about industrial stuff as much, but it's going into industrial devices. Smart meters, smart lights, smart CCTVs, CCTV cameras, etc. It's actually going in right now.
How about medical devices?
Absolutely. Siemens is working on this technology. HP, lots of companies are working on this technology. It's going in there. Why? Because they need 24/7 4G connectivity. You need the broadband for certain things, but for other things, they've got something called narrowband IoT, which is for most of those devices that are low power, have low power requirements. Look, Qualcomm has invested billions of dollars into making sure that these regional other protocols don't defeat what their objective is to be king of the hill. They want to lead you from 4G with IoT and MTM all the way to 5G. Whether it's high bandwidth requirements or low bandwidth requirements, they want their chips in all these devices. It's that simple.
I'm just thinking of all the problems we have with medical devices having this would be a big
deal. Well, here's the problem with medical devices. They work in the ISM band. That's 2.4 gig. There's also no security. But it's, what is ISM? Instrumentation, science, medical. Nobody mentioned that it's lack of security in those bands, but nobody's monitoring those bands. The 4G LTE and the 5G technology is being monitored by the GSMA, monitored by standardization organization. Everybody's monitoring for the quality of service of this wireless technology. I'll take some questions if anybody has any. And I'm sorry this was deer in the headlights, but this stuff hasn't quite reached American shores, and somebody has to explain, right? So I got that job. Thank you.
What about implanted devices?
Into a person's body?
Absolutely.
They're doing now that with NFC. Mm-hmm. I mean, I prefer to just have NFC, Bluetooth, and Wi-Fi on this jacket, quite honestly. And don't laugh, because that's what's going to happen. I've seen it, actually, for NFC. People want to embed it. I'd say it's ridiculous to try to embed metal things into your body. Well, unless it's a pacemaker, I mean, then you have to. But remember the other problem, it's RF radiation, okay? No matter if it's a NFC, which is just 13.6 megahertz frequency band, which is really nothing, right? But 4G LTE connectivity, come on, this is broadband wireless EMI radiation. You do not want things that radiate in your body, except if you have a pacemaker, you have no choice. But in general, I don't want that kind of stuff in my body. I want shielding if I have it in my clothing. If I have it in my embedded watch, it is shielded, it is safeguarded. Otherwise, they can't sell it. The FCC would never allow them to sell it. Any other questions? Tom, no? Was that interesting, useful?
Yeah.
Well, thank you very much. I appreciate that. Sure, no problem.
Me too.
But I just need a business card because I want to see, I need a business card. You want my